commodities in the hands of traders. They know how much commodities there are across this nation, and they know how to get it. They can go to the marketplace and bid the price up of 25 cents a bushel or 35 cents a bushel, and the product comes in, and they can get what they need to profit on it. So we have a great deal of problem with the commodity traders and the statistics developed by government that tells those people and others how much product there is on hand and storage on the farms or in the traders' bins or elsewhere in the country. I think that the government statistics are a depressant upon agriculture prices, on commodity prices, because they tell the people who would be speculators exactly how much commodity is out there and permits them to profit on it rather than you people who are producing it. One of the things that I noticed just recently, that for the week ending November 18, the entries into the corn reserve jumped from 40 million bushels to 83 million bushels. This is equal to the corn that we export at this time from this nation. And what it means is that the farmer today cannot afford to sell his commodities at the market. He has got to hold that grain back on his farm, and he's got to go to the Commodity Credit Corporation for a loan in order to have cash flow to meet his current obligations and to pay his interest. And I'll guarantee you that there will be very few that will retire any debt with the price that they're getting. So we are in a very difficult and dangerous situation when a producer of raw material in this country can't market his commodities, at least at the cost of its production. I think that it's important that we talk about who controls the money supply in this country. And it's not you and I, and it's not the 7,000 members of the Independent Bankers Association. It's in the hands of the large bankers and the large financial corporations, or even foreign investors. Those are the people that are able to manipulate the market to their advantage and to the disadvantage of all of us in this room. And so it's a situation that I think that we are not going to be able to overcome very rapidly. And I presume the thing that probably will have some serious effect upon it will be a deflation or a depression. And I think that the deflation will come because of a depressed situation in this country, and I think we can see it as we look forward. The effect of high interest rates is devastating to small businesses as it is to you farmers. It is devastating to agricultural enterprises, to our cooperatives, and our cooperatives today, let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, are in real danger. Their margin of markup on most of the items that the cooperatives provide today for you and I are less than the cost of the interest that they have to pay to borrow the money, to maintain the inventories, and to pay the interest on the accounts receivable that they naturally carry. So your cooperatives are in danger, and you ought to give serious thought to understanding and determining how you can best help them through a very difficult time. The consumer is hard put because of high interest. Housing is hard put. In fact, housing is in such serious situations that many people in this country who are builders have now found that they can no longer build, that they've had to sit by the wayside or grow out of business. I heard a person from Detroit speaking who is a builder of houses, builder in the construction business, testifying before Congress not long ago, and he was just vivid with concern for what the cost of money was doing to his business. He said you're breaking us. He said, all we want is fair treatment. All we want is a fair price in the marketplace. Nothing different than you people are asking for. But that situation is in a serious situation. And so is the auto industry. And so the thing is spreading. And so it appears that we now are getting closer and closer to a major depression in this country. I don't like to come here and talk to you people and tell you that the situation isn't going to get better, but it's my firm belief that it isn't going to get better for some time. We're going to take our licks, and I think that the licks are not going to be very pleasant. So I think you're going to have to gird for battle. Your friend Vince Roster prepared a chart which he gave to me when I visited him not too long ago, and on it he shows the disparity in the percentage of the national income earned by each sector of the economy. And he compares some figures from 1943 to 1952 with 1980. Do that water. Okay, thank you. with 1980 figures. And I want to just point out to you that the compensation of employees from 1943, 1952 to 1980 had increased only 13+8% of the national economy, national share of the national economy. But going on to income of farm proprietors, you people, you and I, the share of the farm proprietors had declined 82.1% in that period. And so that sets forth some of the problems that you are now facing. Total income of unincorporated businesses declined 51.4%. And rental income of persons declined 46.4%. And total corporate profits, and you hear a lot about corporate profits today, but corporate profits are fast fading. And many of the large industries are reporting reduced corporate profits in the second and third quarter of 1981, and will report even less profits, I believe, in the last quarter. But total corporate profits declined 32.5%. But on the other hand, net interest income, and this is the big disparity, increased 553% in that period. Well, when people pay too much for interest, and those of you in this room and elsewhere have to pay too much to borrow that money, and when you pay to the extent that you do, you create an imbalance that's hard to overcome. You create a problem that can only be solved by a hard-headed government action or possibly resolved because of a depression. And so the interest rate that now we find declining a bit is a serious and ongoing factor that we have to deal with. I think that it's safe to say, and I think I should say it, that there's changing attitudes in the minds of government agencies. There's a changing attitude in the minds of the administration in Washington. And I know that many of you people voted for President Reagan. And I know that many of you people are holding out with the hope that his programs will work. But a question that comes to my mind is, how long can we wait? Will we be here when the situation turns around to where we can again be paid for our production, somewhat in fairness to the cost of production? It's my experience that the Federal Land Bank, which has now become an essential lender for reopening of loans or for making of new real estate loans because you've exhausted the means of borrowing against your personal property or against other credit that you have, has now reached the point to where they're in our particular area, they're charging 7.75% front-end points. Now, they call this an origination fee, but on a $100,000 loan, that's $7,750. Coming right off the top that you have to pay to get this money, and then you're going to borrow the money on a variable interest rate that is set by their cost of funds. So it's becoming mighty expensive. The PCA is on a variable interest rate, as are most of the banks today. They have found that it's necessary that they no longer make term loans or fixed interest loans. They found it necessary now that the loans be tied to a variable interest rate and then move up and down as their cost of funds move up and down. The PCA has become very cautious, as has other lenders. The Farmers Home Administration has an entirely different attitude, in my judgment, an attitude that now is changing directions. When the Farmers Home Administration was first put into place, it was there for the purpose of getting young farmers started, there for the purpose of helping some farmers to get recapitalized, refinanced so that they could stay in business. Today, they are screening and looking very carefully at the cash flow that any of their borrowers have, and if those funds don't come up, they're encouraging them to sell out. And in many cases, they're right, because staying at these high costs, the high cost of interest and the high cost of energy and the other factors that they have, leads only to one conclusion, is that if they stay, they'll stay long enough and use up whatever equity they have in their lands, and they'll end up out of business anyway. So I can't be too critical of them, but I use that to point up to you the severity of the situation that we find ourselves in this country from a financial standpoint. I mentioned that in the past that you used to be able to borrow money at a fixed rate, you used to be able to borrow money on a long term, and you used to be able to depend upon renewing the debt if it was on an annual basis. Today, that whole situation has changed. We're now going to have whether it be the Farm Credit Administration or whether it be banks or insurance companies or other government agencies, the Farmers Home Administration, it's all going to be tied to the cost of funds. And you are not going to have any freedom really in determining how much you're going to have to pay. You're going to have to go to the lender, you're going to have to bite the bullet, and you're going to have to pay the rates established, because the banker or the lender can do nothing about it excepting to react to the market rates established by others who have control of the money supply. And I think here that one should recognize that the Federal Reserve has made a significant effort in trying to control inflation. But their major weapon that they've used is increasing the rate of interest, increasing the discount rate, encouraging the prime rate to remain high, controlling the rate on Fed funds, which banks lend to each other on a day-to-day basis. They have artificially set a high rate. And in so doing, they have caused great problems to you, to small businesses, to the auto industry, to housing, and to the government itself. The government is the largest borrower in this nation. And when the Federal Reserve does this, it means that our government goes to the market and borrows money at 15 and 16 and 17%, something unheard of in the history of this country. And it isn't good. And at the same time, our government, for some unknown reason to me, will go out and borrow money at these high rates and go out to the year 2000 or the 2009. And what they say to me is that they simply are locking in a high interest factor on government borrowing for 30 years. And I can't for the life of me understand the economics of that, but I'm a country boy, and I guess there's pretty good reasons why I can't. In Minnesota recently, we have had people starting to speak out about the severity of the recession, which many people now recognize as a depression. Minnesota in 1974 and 1975 rode through what was called a recession or a depression, basically a recession at that time, because our mining industry was healthy, and our farming industry was healthy too, because we were still feeling the effects of the Russian grain deal. And so we rode through this when the rest of the country was having a depression. We rode through it without any real noticeable change in the economy. But that's not true today. Economists from some of the large banks in Minneapolis now point out that we are in a recession, that Minnesota now has the worst of two worlds. Farm commodity prices badly depressed, and the mining industry laying off people, shutting down, and we have deep unemployment excepting in the Minneapolis-St. Paul metropolitan area, and even there, that equals the national unemployment rate. So it is being recognized today that there are serious problems facing this country, and there's problems that you and I are going to be, to some degree, more or less, a recipient of, and we may not like the treatment we're going to get. There are some people who are trying to do some things about it. There is a low-interest council forming today, which has rather broad support, who would like to see interest rates move down by government action. They would like to see the Federal Reserve reverse its policy. They would like to see the Federal Reserve seats occupied by persons other than economists and bankers, but we have more and more economists occupying the seats on the Federal Reserve Board each year, and these people are proposing some things that should be considered and would be solutions to some of these problems. But the problem is here very similar to the problem that you have. You know where you want to go, and you know what you ought to do, and that's to get a hold of the market and market your product. These people are going to try to get a hold of the ears of the Congress and the administration and others and try to bring about a sane reckoning or a sane program for setting interest rates that will meet the needs of this country and treat the people who need these funds fairly. But they've got a long, hard row to hoe. I could go on for quite a while, but I think that Dora said that I wouldn't speak too long and I would try to respond to some questions. And I think that that's what I'd like to do, but before I do, I'd like to tell you a little story. This is a story about a NFO member who was hunting with his attorney. And he was up in northern Minnesota, and it was a cold, blustery night, and they were in a tent. And during the night, the farmer heard some noise outside, and he wasn't sleeping quite as well as the attorney, so he stuck his head out the tent door and looked, and here was a ferocious black bear. And the black bear was snarling around like that, and the farmer pulled back in, and he said to his attorney friend, he said, "Boy," he said, "we're in trouble." He said, "There's a bear out there, and he's heading for this tent," and he said, "he's going to get something. He's hungry." And the attorney looked at him and he said, "Well, my gosh, what are we going to do?" And the farmer said, "Well," he said, "I don't know about you, but I'm going to do something." And he dove into his barracks bag, pulled out a pair of running shoes, and he started to tie on those running shoes. And the attorney looked at him and he said, "Well, my God," he said, "Bill," he said, "what are you going to do with those running shoes?" He said, "You can't outrun that bear." He said, "Well," he said, "you don't understand. The only person I have to outrun is you." So thank you very much for listening to me and inviting me to be with you tonight. And as Doris said, I will try to respond.
We do have a floor mic over here. Would it be better if you dragged it up through the middle here, maybe? And then we didn't intend for him to be so brief that he'd quit early, you know, but ask the kind of questions. Here's your opportunity to learn something about that banking mystique. It's been kind of like some of the other professions you don't understand too well. Lawyers have got their deal, you know, and you never really understand what's going on in some of those circles. And so you have an opportunity tonight to ask something of general or specific interest to you. Yes. Repeat the question, rephrase it, would you?
No. Well, the question is, do I think that the Reagan program will bring an improvement to this nation's economy without paying the producer of raw material a fair price for its production? Is that your question? I think that the present administration is going in a different route. I think the present administration is bent on cutting the budget, and this means cutting federal appropriations. And I think that this administration accepts the fact that you people and other people like you in this nation will produce adequately for this nation's domestic needs and for foreign export, regardless of the price. The question was twofold. One is, how deep is the recession or depression going to get? And the answer to that is, I don't know. But I'm scared to death. Again, I don't know. But the other question was, who do they sell out to? And I think that's an important question. I know that in my particular area today, there are farmers who are in a depressed financial condition. And they're being told by persons that their way out is to sell and to recover the equity that they have in their lands and their personal property if they haven't gone beyond that. But it's true, today with high interest rates where they are, it's mighty difficult to find a buyer who can afford to acquire your land and add it to his, or to an entrepreneur or speculator who wants to buy land hoping that someplace down the road we'll see higher land prices and he can profit. Yes, sir.
Still haven't answered the question, who do you sell it to? If you can't find someone to sell it to, you just have to eliminate the fund.
Well, I think I attempted to answer it, but my answer would be is that if you can't find a buyer who can afford the interest rate or afford the price, you can't sell it. And that's exactly what's happening now in several cases that I know of.
So what happens to the price of land?
Well, I think the price of land is going to go down, but there are persons who are very knowledgeable that will tell you and tell anyone in this room that 10 years from now that the price of land may be double what it is today. It's hard for me to believe, but I think that we are on the verge of seeing land not moving, and I think that because of that we'll see a lesser price for lands that do move. Yes, sir.
I believe I can talk loud enough from here. I would like to hear your comment on branch banking versus your independent banks and your position relative to ours, so to speak, and the large cooperation that is likely to step in behind us. Branch banking against your independent bank right now.
All right, let me ask you where you're from, please.
Missouri.
Okay. Well, Missouri is a unit bank state yet, so you have many, many independent banks, many, many community banks. I come from a state, Minnesota, which has multibank holding companies, and we have two giant multibank holding companies in our state. We have 753 banks in the state. The holding companies own about 128 of those banks. And so the rest of the banks there, 500 and some strong, are independent community banks. Now, those independent community banks have a stake in the community. That bank is owned by people who reside in that community or in its adjacent area. And it's their philosophy, it has been their philosophy and is today, that they're there to serve that community and provide banking services at the most reasonable price that they can based upon economic factors that they have no control over. And so, therefore, I think that you will find the banking industry providing the capital needed, providing the farmer and the businessman can raise the cash to service the debt, and that means afford to pay the interest rate. I think that you will find that the community banker has two good eyes, and you may find that the corporate banker has one glass eye. You know, the question was brought up here a little bit ago about the underpayment for raw material production. And I know this was Red Paulson's thesis for time after time, and I certainly subscribe to it. And it's been my contention that whenever you underpay the producer of raw material, that you shortchange the nation, that you shortchange the federal government, the state government, the communities, our educational system. And what happens? When you do this, you end up with people unemployed, you end up with your teachers on strike, and that's going on in my community right now. Our teachers have been out for 20-some days. They've been out all of the month of November now, and this is because we don't have the funds to pay them, and the funds have been cut off from the federal government, cut off from the state government. So, it boils right down to it. If we want this country to be prosperous and we want it to move forward, we better start paying you, the producer, at least the cost of your production and a reasonable profit. That's what everybody in business expects.
Do you have much land in your state being bought by foreign owners?
In Minnesota, we do not have a lot of corporate farming or foreign investors coming in. There's some. But I think the last figures I saw, there was about 3%. There's a question over here.
You see that the co-ops are in trouble. Our local co-op has $1.5 million accounts receivable. Now, I'm wondering what these co-ops are going to do if these farmers can't pay up these accounts receivable. What is their choice?
Well, a cooperative, is kind of like a cat. It's got 9 lives, providing you people take care of it. You got to nurse it when it's sick, and it's sick now. You're seeing now mergers of central cooperatives, regional cooperatives, because of the scale of the economics of scale. They've got to do this in order to be competitive in the marketplace. And so, therefore, I think the situation you describe, I'll bet you would tell me that your cooperative will be in the red at the end of its year. With that type of accounts receivable, and certainly they have to borrow that money because the equities are diminishing. So it's telling me that cooperative is going to be in the red. And how long can it remain in the red? I think our cooperatives are in deep, deep trouble. And it backs up. In Minnesota this year, we had a very wet October. And so therefore, we couldn't get the crops out. And so therefore, every merchant that was providing services or product to our farmers had to wait, and they understood, and they did wait, And our cooperatives, like your cooperative, had accounts receivable up to here. And their managers were coming to say and say, well, what shall we do? What can we do? Well, about the only thing they could do is to put off paying some of their bills, too. And so it backs up on us. It's a serious thing. Sir?
Pat, I'm Dalton Minder from up here in South Dakota. And I count a lot of bankers. Is that an issue?
Not really. They're not too bad if you get to know them.
Well, the reason I say this, I have a question, but before I want to make a comment. I talked about 30 different bankers from Wichita, Kansas to Aberdeen, South Dakota in the last about 10 weeks. And I find that in visiting with bankers, they're like the pulse of a community. In 15 minutes, I can find out how a community is doing just by visiting an independent or American banker. I'll give you guys that much credit. I respect you a lot more than a corporate bank. Now, my question is this. How close are we, because we need help as farmers, to you people in the Independent Banking Association and the American Bankers Association to give out just little words of encouragement to farmers to organize?
First of all, thank you very much for the kind remarks. And second, you have in the American banking system, bankers who are free and willing and capable of urging farmers and others to organize so that they can present a collective front. But you have many, many who feel that they shall not become involved in the National Farmers Organization or the Farmers Union or the Bureau or the Grange or any of these organizations, because they feel uncomfortable trying to tell you people how to run your business. And it's too bad. We have a stake in your business, and we ought to be willing to share our experience and our knowledge, if that's what it is, with you as we encourage you to do a better job of organizing. And I, for one, have been involved time after time in encouraging farm organizations to become larger, better informed, and with outstanding leadership to present your cause. And this is a good illustration of exactly what I've felt is necessary. But it's got to be bigger, and it's got to become more hard-nosed, if you like. It's got to be more persuasive. And I noticed some buttons around here gripe. Well, I know what that means. That means you're beginning to realize that you've got to be able to apply political pressure. And this is the name of the game today. You're going to have some help from government. And that means you're going to have to get the attention of Congress. And one of the ways you get the attention of Congress is by being able to send somebody to see them, in particular doing a campaign to make a contribution. Whether you like it or not, that's the way the game is played in Washington. And so you have to be realistic. Your collective bargaining is the road to go, and you ought to go with all your might. But you can't stop there. You've got to be persuasive in Washington, because if we didn't have a commodity credit program in place right now, we'd probably stop the system. There wouldn't be a cash flow to pay the cooperative bills, to pay the interest to my bank, to pay the fuel oil dealer, to pay the fertilizer dealer. That's how serious I think it is. There was a question over here. Yes, sir.
Yes, as a banker, have you ever personally advised a farmer coming in and talking to you or your bank advising them that maybe they could join a collective bargaining organization to solve their problems?
Well, I'm a little bit different than many bankers is because I was in the front of encouraging farmers to join NFO in its early stages some 20 years ago. I spoke to their meetings similar to this on one or two occasions, and at that time I told them, in my judgment, they were on the right track and they better get organized and get at it. But I can't speak for all bankers. I don't know what their attitude is on. You know that NFO went through some growing stages. There was a time when it was under attack, and there was a time when you people were standing alone on many of the issues. But you've come of age, and you've proven that through collective bargaining you can affect the market, and you're accepted. And I think that you will find general acceptance and good recognition on the part of bankers throughout this country that you're on the right road and you're entitled to do what you are. That was Pat Dubois, past president of the Independent Bankers Association.